Tiffany's ready to clerk for me. It's nice to be back in Chicago, even if your weather is, for my taste, inhospitable. But for Chicago taste, it's actually pretty good. I want to talk today about an historical event in the city where I now live and work, and its lessons for us today. August 11th of last year marked the 102nd anniversary of a heinous crime, the murder of a Catholic priest, followed 2 months later by an infamous trial that garnered national attention and stained the reputation of the judicial system of Birmingham, Alabama. Now, that stain came from the influence of racial and religious bigotry, especially the power of the Ku Klux Klan, and it lingered long afterward because the lead defense lawyer at the trial, Hugo Black, later rose to high offices, prompting others to investigate and question his earlier conduct. This history raises serious questions about professional ethics and morality and offers enduring lessons for lawyers and judges. Before addressing those questions and related lessons, I want first to discuss the murder and the events that led to it. I will then address the trial and the role of Hugo Black and other lawyers and the relevant judges. You should keep in mind that I'll quote a lot from the language from 1921, and some of the terminology will be offensive to modern ears, but recognize I am quoting. In 1921, Birmingham was a relatively young city, only 50 years old. Even so, it was already the largest municipality in Alabama, comparable in size then to Atlanta, and boasted having the tallest skyscrapers in the South at the corner of First Avenue North and 20th Street, what was then called the so-called heaviest corner on Earth. Nicknamed Magic City, Birmingham boomed in population and economic growth with busy railroads and a rising steel industry. Racially segregated, Birmingham had the highest composition of black residents, 38% of any major American city. But bigotry in Birmingham involved more than race. By 1920, anti-Catholic bigotry was rampant, and the revived Ku Klux Klan exercised tremendous influence. The Birmingham police chief, Thomas Shirley, like most officers on his force, and many judges and elected officials, belonged to the Klan. Shirley belonged specifically to Robert E. Lee, Claver No. 1, and sat on its Imperial Council. No wonder Charles Sweeney of The Nation magazine back then described Birmingham as, quote, the American hotbed of anti-Catholic fanaticism. Now, let me give you a flavor of the atmosphere. In 1919, the Alabama legislature passed a convent inspection law allowing warrantless searches of convents, seminaries, and hospitals by inspectors appointed by the governor, thanks to a conspiracy theory that Catholics kidnapped Protestant girls and enslaved them. State and local politicians successfully campaigned on anti-Catholic platforms. In Birmingham, the Klan distributed placards with the letters TWK, standing for Trade with Klansmen, for local businesses to display in store windows and to discourage buying from Catholic merchants, most of whom were immigrants. Klansmen also were suspected of burning a Catholic church in Pratt City, which is nearby. In January 1921, 1,000 Klansmen gathered in Birmingham on the state fairgrounds to initiate hundreds of new members with a large crossbow. In April, Klansmen in Talladega County stripped and tied a Catholic pharmacist, Pierce Bartling, to a tree and beat him, breaking his jaw and knocking out most of his teeth. On Flag Day, hundreds of Klansmen paraded in cars and motorcycles from the streets of Birmingham to Bessemer. Afterward, a crowd flocked to a downtown theater to watch a movie, The Face at Your Window, promoted by the Klan. 2 months later, on the evening of August 11th, Father James Coyle, the pastor of St. Paul's Church on the corner of 3rd Avenue North and 22nd Street, quietly prayed, reading his breviary, sitting on the front porch of the rectory. A Klansman named Edwin Stephenson, dressed in a dark suit, walked to the porch, drew a pistol, fired 3 shots, and killed Father Coyle with a bullet to his head. Stephenson then calmly walked away and surrendered himself to police officers at the Jefferson County Courthouse next door to the rectory, while Coyle's sister Marcella and others rushed to aid the priest. Coyle and Stephenson led different lives. A native of Ireland, James Edwin Coyle earned a degree from a Jesuit university in Ireland and then studied theology in Rome, where he was ordained in 1896 at the age of 23. He began his ministry as a priest in Mobile, first in parish missions and then at McGill Institute for Boys as a teacher and later rector. In 1904, the Bishop of Mobile appointed him to serve as pastor of St. Paul's. Father Coyle was a poet, highly literate, and a frequent writer of letters published in the Birmingham newspapers defending the Catholic Church and his native Ireland. He was the most prominent and controversial Catholic in Birmingham. His parishioners loved him, though they often feared for his safety. Edwin Stephenson was a former barber who reinvented himself as a Methodist minister, though he lacked any formal training and had been ordained years earlier as only a deacon. Nicknamed the Marrying Parson, Stephenson had no church. For a fee, He performs quickie weddings for couples applying for marriage licenses at the county courthouse. Stephenson belonged to the same clavern as the police chief. Years earlier, Stephenson participated in the lynching of a black man in Georgia. And as he lived on Third Avenue North in the shadow of the towering spires of St. Paul's, Stephenson seethed with hatred for Father Coyle and the Catholic Church. The intersection of the men's lives involved Stephenson's only daughter, Ruth, who had recently turned 18. On the day of his murder, Father Coyle had officiated at the marriage of Ruth Stephenson and Pedro Guzman, a Puerto Rican employed locally as a paper hanger. Ruth met Pedro when he performed work at her family's home several years earlier. And Ruth enraged her parents when she later informed them that she had become a Catholic at Our Lady of Sorrows Church. When Ruth left work early on August 11th and could not be found, Stephenson frantically searched for her and retrieved his pistol. He later said, implausibly, that he sought Father Coyle's assistance in locating Ruth, and that the priest then informed him that he had officiated earlier at their marriage, at her marriage to Pedro, also a Catholic. Stephenson then said, even more implausibly, that the priest struck him and appeared to reach for a weapon, and that he shot Father Coyle in self-defense. But no such weapon was found, and witnesses saw no signs of a struggle and heard no argument between the men. A grand jury eventually returned an indictment against Stephenson on the charge of second-degree murder, even though the circuit solicitor, Joseph Tate, argued correctly that the evidence supported a charge of first-degree murder. Tate spent weeks presenting evidence to the grand jury, but its members expressed sympathy for the notion that Stephenson had perhaps acted in self-defense. The Klan quickly raised substantial funds for Stephenson's defense lawyers, all but one of whom were Klansmen. The exception was Hugo Black, the former county solicitor. Joe Tate and Hugo Black had a history of animosity. In 1916, the legislature consolidated the county and circuit solicitor offices, which led to a power struggle between the men. Black had only recently been elected county solicitor, but Tate prevailed when a court ruled that Black could not use county funds to pay his assistants. Tate took charge of all local prosecutions, and Black entered a lucrative private practice. Stephenson's trial was assigned to Judge William Fort, a reported Klansman and an old friend of Hugo Black. After he took charge of the defense, Black supplemented the earlier plea of not guilty by reason of self-defense with a plea of not guilty by reason of temporary insanity. Now, the two pleas were inconsistent. The first, self-defense, asserted a rational act, and the second, temporary insanity, asserted the opposite. But the press reported that this new plea, quote, would throw the gates wide open for the introduction of testimony of the most varied nature, including testimony about Stephenson's views on Catholicism, his alleged troubles with his daughter, his opposition to her marriage, and the other things which the defense may claim caused him to become temporarily insane, end quote. Indeed, before Black added that plea, a notorious anti-Catholic publication, The New Menace, which had a national circulation of over a million, argued that Stephenson was justified in killing Father Coyle because he, quote, would rather have seen his daughter in her grave than a member of the papal church married to a Catholic destined to bring into the world a generation of half-breed slaves to the papal system, end quote. The New Menace complained that a plea of self-defense made this evidence irrelevant. Before the trial, the publisher of the New Menace visited Stephenson in his jail cell, and Hugo Black later added the new plea. When the trial started on October the 17th, the Birmingham News called it the biggest criminal trial from many angles ever held in Alabama. A crowd of spectators overflowed into the hallway. National newspapers and wire services sent reporters. The prosecution presented a quick and simple case, as second-degree murder required no proof of premeditation, and Stephenson's firing of a bullet to Father Coyle's head created a presumption of an intentional murder. The state called the attending physician from St. Vincent's Hospital, who determined the cause of death. It then called Father Coyle's sister, Marcella, who found him on the porch after she heard the gunshots and saw Stephenson walking away. And it called two witnesses who heard the first shot and then saw Stephenson fire the second and third. They testified that Stephenson fired the shots while standing upright and that someone later threw a chair off the porch to make way for ambulance workers, both facts that undercut a theory of self-defense that had been suggested by Stephenson's lawyers at a preliminary hearing. The state's final witness testified that he threw the chair from the porch, which meant that it had not been knocked over in a struggle between the men. Following the testimonies of Coyle's sister and the physician at the Catholic Hospital, Hugo Black made sure that the jury knew that the third witness was Mary. The state's final witness testified that he threw the chair from the porch.
Indeed, after repeatedly
knocking it over, and the struggles had been drinking.
His daughter prohibition and began brave that a member of the papal church,
Hugo Black, married to a for the fourth solicitor witness, his last question to her power.
You're Catholic, aren't you, Mr. McGinty?
For the final witness, Black asked, you belong to that church. He then reiterated, you've been going to this church ever since you were about 11. After calling several characteristics of Stephenson, the defense called Hugo Black, police and deputies the fourth solicitor his last
about Stephenson's
to her power
excited
condition
following the shooting.
For the final witness,
but none could
Black
say,
asked him, you belong to
When Black called Stephenson's wife,
the legislature consolidated
began by making the case
in circuit solicitor office.
He asked,
what church
do power struggles between the men?
Then Black had
only recently been elected county solicitor.
So far as you know, prevailed any of your court people ever belong.
Black had not used county funds to
Black then asked Mary about the problems she and her husband had been having with Ruth over Catholicism. Mary recounted enlisting the assistance of Police Chief Shirley to retrieve Ruth from hiding at Fred Bender's house. The Benders had served as Ruth's godparents when she became Catholic. The Stephensons then sent Ruth to Texas to visit relatives, but she ran away. Black asked, where did you find her? Mary answered, found her in a Catholic hospital. When Black asked Mary about the afternoon of the shooting, Mary explained that she sought the sheriff's help in getting a warrant to search some places she thought Ruth might be. Black asked, what places? Mary answered, Catholic places. Black then turned to race. He elicited that Mary and Edwin were unaware of Ruth's relationship with Pedro with the shooting.
Mary explained that she thought that
she
knew
whether he was a green
getting a warrant
Puerto Rican places
or Dago
Ruth
might be.
Black asked,
she answered, half Greek.
What places?
Black
Mary
asked,
answered,
could he talk
Catholic
English
places?
Mary said,
Black then turned to race.
Understand.
He elicited that Mary,
Hugo Black next called his
line there, Stephen's relationship, and was soon asked, have you ever belonged to the Catholic Church? Then he asked, have any of your people, so far as you know, back through the generations, as far as can be traced, ever belonged to the Catholic Church? Stephenson answered, no. Then Black turned to the problems with Ruth's interest in Catholicism and the time the police recovered her from the Bender's house. Black asked, had you in your home tried to rear her as a Christian girl? Black then asked about the search for Ruth after she left her job early. Stephenson implausibly alleged that as he passed the rectory of St. Paul, Father Coyle invited him to have a seat. Stephenson then allegedly asked Coyle to assist him in finding his daughter, but Coyle informed him that his daughter was a Catholic and that he had officiated at her marriage to Hussman, a Catholic, that afternoon. Stephenson then said he told Father Coyle, you have treated me as dirty as a dog. You have ruined my home. That man is a Negro. Stephenson alleged that Coyle then called him a heretical son of a bitch and hit and kicked him before appearing to reach for a weapon. Then Stephenson alleged that he shot Coyle in self-defense. But earlier that afternoon, after receiving a call from the rectory telling him that Ruth and Pedro had appeared at St. Paul's asking to be married, Father Coyle presciently told a fellow priest, "Stephenson will probably kill me for this." Then something extraordinary happened. Hugo Black asked the bailiff to bring Pedro Guzman into the courtroom. Black had the courtroom blinds lowered to darken the room, and after the bailiff presented Guzman, Black asked his client, "Is that Pedro Guzman?" Stephenson said yes. Black then said, "Bring him closer to the jury. Let them look at his eyes." Then Black declared, "I just wanted you to see that man." A prosecutor cross-examined Stephenson about his ill will toward the Catholic Church and the implausibility of his alleged encounter with Father Coyle. Then he cross-examined Stephenson about whether Pedro Guzman was Black. When Stephenson insisted, "I say I look on him as such," the prosecutor said, "I asked you whether or not you know he is a Negro." Hugo Black objected, insisting that Stephenson had said Guzman was Black as far as a man could tell. Black explained he could not trace his lineage, very difficult to trace some of it. In its rebuttal, the state called Pedro Guzman as a witness. State asked, "What nationality are you?" Guzman answered, "Spanish descent." When Tate asked where his parents were born, Guzman responded, "Barcelona, Spain." Tate then elicited that Guzman had lived in the United States for 24 years, had known Ruth for 8 years, and that Father Coyle had not known before that day that he and Ruth wanted to marry. On cross-examination, Hugo Black asked Guzman, "Where were you born?" Guzman responded, "Puerto Rico." Black then asked how Guzman could know where his parents were born, and "Did you ever see either one of them in Spain?" Guzman admitted he had not visited Spain. Black then handed Guzman a newspaper clipping and asked, "Is that your picture?" Guzman admitted it was a photo from an arrest before officers later determined he was not the subject of an outstanding warrant and released him. Hugo Black stated, quote, "That was the picture of you that was made before you were dressed up and had your hair worked on." Black continued, "When that picture was taken, you had not been to the barber shop just before, had you?" Guzman answered, "No, sir, they took me for my word." Black then asked, "You've had the curls worked out since then?" Guzman replied, "I had a haircut." Black asked, "Didn't smooth it down?" Guzman replied, "No, sir." Black kept on, "Has anything been done to your hair since that picture was taken?" Guzman insisted, "No, sir, don't use anything on my hair." Black then asked again, "Nothing has been done to your hair since that picture was made?" Guzman said no. Hugo Black sat down. The state also called a newly discovered witness, Douglas White, who had witnessed the entire encounter between Stephenson and Father Coyle. Black objected, "Now we object to any questions to this witness which are not clearly in rebuttal." He complained that the state had no right to hold back an eyewitness, not proper rebuttal testimony at all, he said. Judge Ford told Tate to confine the witness to rebuttal testimony. Tate explained that White was a proper witness because he saw Stephenson shoot Father Coyle immediately when he reached the porch, and that the men exchanged no words, and Father Coyle did not strike him. So White's testimony directly contradicted Stephenson's. Hugo Black erupted. "They can't split it up like that." The objection was meritless, but Judge Ford sustained it. Tate insisted the witness also had not been previously known. Black objected. The judge sustained his objection. Tate pleaded that the prosecutors had diligently searched for witnesses, but the judge again ruled for the defense. In closing, the prosecutors argued that they had proved Stephenson's guilt beyond reasonable doubt. Stephenson murdered Father Coyle out of religious hatred. He had not acted in self-defense. Father Coyle wasn't armed with even, quote, a pocket knife. The prosecutors begged the jury to give Father Coyle equal protection of the law. Hugo Black insisted in his closing argument that he, quote, had not appealed to any passion or prejudice. He argued that the prosecutors had injected religion into the case. He described the state's third and fourth witnesses as, quote, Siamese twins.
and said they were, quote, brothers in falsehood as well as in faith. Black said, because a man becomes a priest does not mean that he is divine. He argued he has no more right to protection than a Protestant minister, even though the prosecutors asked only for equal treatment. He maintained, quote, a child of a Methodist does not suddenly depart from her religion unless someone has planted in her mind the seeds of influence. And he argued that when a daughter reared well has been persuaded from her parents by some cause or person, that cause or person is wrong. Black then turned to Pedro Guzman. He argued there are 20 mulattoes to every Negro in Puerto Rico. He continued, if Pedro Guzman was, as the state had said, of proud Castilian descent, he has descended a long way. He challenged the prosecutors, if the eyes of the world upon the verdict of this jury, I would write that verdict in words that cannot be misunderstood. The homes of the people of Birmingham cannot be touched. If that brings disgrace, God brings the disgrace. A few hours after the judge charged the jury, it returned its verdict. Not guilty. Stephenson was released from detention and paraded around the state and given a seat of honor at Klan rallies before he returned to his ministry as the marrying parson. James Esdale, the head of the Alabama Klan, would later say, Hugo didn't have much trouble winning that verdict, which perhaps explains why Edwin Stephenson appeared to be so calm throughout the trial. But the day after the verdict, Governor Emmett O'Neill complained to a large meeting of alumni at the University of Alabama at the Tutwiler Hotel, quote, that a jury in Jefferson County has made open season in Alabama for the killing of Catholics. He said, we have not advanced very far from savagery or barbarism if murder would be justified on account of the religious creed of the victim. A former United States attorney and past president of the state bar, Governor O'Neill also suggested perhaps Alabama needed a new method of securing stronger, abler, and more courageous judges to enforce our criminal law. 2 years later, Hugo Black became a member of the Ku Klux Klan by taking its oath at a rally attended by a crowd of 25,000. The Klan later helped elect Black to the United States Senate. When President Franklin Roosevelt appointed Black to the Supreme Court, an investigative reporter for the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, Ray Spiegel, uncovered Black's earlier membership in the Klan and his conduct in the Stephenson trial. Embarrassed, Hugo Black downplayed his membership in the Klan. Quote, I was a joiner, he said. He insisted that the Klan was a fraternal organization, not anti-Catholic, anti-Jewish, or anti-Negro. Of course, Hugo Black would go on to serve honorably on the Supreme Court, where he joined not only the unanimous decision in Brown versus Board of Education, declaring unconstitutional racial segregation in public schools, but also Loving versus Virginia, declaring unconstitutional laws prohibiting interracial marriage. But his earlier decision to join this mass gang of domestic terrorists was scandalous. This historical event has long fascinated me. For 20 years as a federal judge, I have worked in chambers in the Hugo Black Courthouse. My wife and I worship at St. Paul's Cathedral, where our older daughter was baptized. For many years, we worshiped in Our Lady of Sorrows, where Ruth became a Catholic. Father Coyle taught and served as rector at the Catholic High School in Mobile, where I and my father graduated, and where my father taught and later as a permanent deacon served as rector. I keep a framed photo of Father Coyle near my desk and sometimes look on it, saying their prayer, Requiem Scott and Pace, that he used for the title of a poet. I do not offer this historical account to condemn Hugo Black, like all of us, an imperfect man. But his trial tactics were dishonorable. His blatant appeals to racial and religious bigotry were objectively wrong. The lessons of this history are timeless. A lawyer's call is not to win at any cost. Whether you can get away with a tactic that might benefit your client is not the sole measure of its propriety. The end does not justify the means. The rules of professional conduct require more. A lawyer owes his client zealous representation, to be sure,
But that duty is tempered by moral and ethical responsibilities. A lawyer owes a duty of respect to the decorum and impartiality of the court so that every case may be decided according to law, not based on appeals to prejudice. A lawyer also owes a duty of fairness to opposing counsel and parties. A lawyer also owes respect to the rights of third persons, like Pedro Guzman, an innocent man whom Hugo Black ridiculed as racially inferior and a vulgar appeal to bigotry. A lawyer must maintain professional independence as an officer of the court. In contrast with Hugo Black, Joe Tate and the other prosecutors performed admirably, despite the hostile atmosphere of the community. At the time, newspaper reporters speculated that the prosecutors had not tried hard to obtain a conviction. But in recent years, objective reviewers have concluded otherwise. The first account came in 2004 in a student note in the Alabama Law Review, where the author concluded that the Klan's reach stopped short of the solicitor's office. In 2010, the definitive scholarship came in a book, Rising Rogue, by a former prosecutor and law professor, Karen Davis. She argued persuasively that the prosecutors did their duty as ministers of justice in obtaining an indictment from the grand jury. And she explained why, after the grand jury returned a charge of second-degree murder, the prosecutors had no cause to present a more elaborate case at trial. Newspapers questioned the prosecutor's decision not to call Ruth as a witness, but her immature enjoyment of the limelight of the grand jury, and she explained why after
her testimony before the grand jury,
charge of second-degree murder, prosecutors had no
testimony would like to
present a more elaborate case at trial.
The all-male, all-white
newspapers questioned the prosecutor's decision not to call.
Performance of the judges was mixed,
but Judge Abernathy,
her immature enjoyment of the limelight of the grand jury, and she explained why after
her testimony before the grand jury,
prosecutors
had no testimony
would like to present a more elaborate case.
He probably
the all-male,
newspapers questioning the prosecutor's decision judgment.
The performance of the judges along with
Judge Abernathy,
her
immature enjoyment of the limelight here in the grand jury.
It's really as you can explain why
after her testimony,
they have
tried to present a second degree murder prosecutors.
But Judge Corwin,
for like presenting
more elaborate case.
He probably
the all-male,
newspapers questioning the prosecutor's decision
judgment. The
performance of the judges
along with
Judge Abernathy,
her immature
of selecting criminal trial judges back then. So the quest for justice in this fallen world is never complete. But as lawyers and judges, we owe the people our best efforts to the end that we may have a government of laws, not of men. So may we continue to learn from history and always strive for justice by upholding the rule of law. Thank you. Any questions? How much time do we have?
Oh, we have a good time.
And you can ask me questions about other things too, but no guarantee I'll answer those. It'll depend.
Frank, I have a question. I've heard this speech a few times, so.
We all needed to know that.
No, I love it. It's a great speech. But I would like to know, so once Hugo Black got nominated and all this stuff came out, I mean, today, if that happened, it would be, I mean, number one, it would have been found a lot earlier. There's no way he would have been nominated. But what were his just... What were his justifications at the time, and how hard was the scrutiny?
He said that the Klan was like the Rotary Club, or the Kiwanis Club, and he was busy building a practice and being a politician, and Hugo Black, by the way, was a very talented trial lawyer by all accounts, and his private practice was lucrative, but his take was, joining the Klan was just like joining any other local organization. I didn't know anything about it being anti-Black, anti-Jewish, anti-Catholic. That was essentially his
defense. And that wasn't common knowledge at that point, 19, whatever. that's racist.
Oh, well, of course everybody knew what the Klan was. look, Hugo Black actually had a radio address. And he basically, if you go back and read the address, he basically made this about the accusers and how they weren't to be trusted, and he was in many ways making an appeal that was xenophobic. A lot of it had to do with immigration to some extent, and maybe Catholics as well. It's more subtle. You can go back and read it, but it's not pretty. Philip Hamburger's book, Separation of Church and State. I don't know how many of you are from. How many know who Philip Hamburger is? You know, professor, probably one of our greatest legal historians today. Teaches at Columbia. He wrote a book called Separation of Church and State, and he traces that phrase. And shows how so much of it was linked to, you know, we think about it coming from Thomas Jefferson's letter to the Danbury Baptist, but it was really a phrase that was used frequently by the Know Nothing Party, by the Klan, and was really closely tied to anti-Catholicism, and Professor Hamburger has a section in his book. It's not nearly as elaborate as Professor Damon's book, Rising Road. He has a section on this, and he has, I believe, reproduced in that book a long quote from Hugo Black's radio address. And if we go back and read, you know, that address, the address itself that worked for his public defense was itself offensive. A lot of things have changed. Yes, sir.
I'm curious, so there's kind of a jury nullification problem. If like a local community is so dedicated to making sure that someone blatantly commits a crime, they receive a not guilty verdict. The jury system is designed to protect the rights of the accused, but maybe is more imperfect with the rights of victims if the jury is very sympathetic to the defendant. What can the justice system do by like local community are, you know, using kind of the jury nullification process to basically provide these kind of immunity for crimes? And do you have any suggestions on how we should deal with cases, even in modern times where it may be a less of an egregious case, but still that's been a concern?
Well, you can imagine in 1921 that a jury wasn't drawn from the entire community. It's important now that we have more representative jury veneres, which we do. I think we've made a lot of progress with that. We also have searching voir dire, so we really try to ask important questions of jurors to make sure that we're going to get individuals who will follow the instructions of the court and judge the case fairly and have an open mind. And then we have to depend on the rules of evidence and an honest judge who's going to properly instruct the jury on the law and also keep out irrelevant material, but also police potential misconduct of the lawyers who will be tempted to make appeals to prejudice that are irrelevant. And beyond that, I don't know that we can do it. I mean, the system is designed to allow for, you know, nine guilty to go free. To protect the one innocent person from a wrongful conviction. I have no quarrel with that. I think the system ought to be one that puts the burden on the state to a high burden. But I think the safeguards, that many of which have developed since the time of this trial, have improved. In this time period, a huge percentage of white males in Birmingham would have probably been Klansmen, at least on the jury venari. The jury venari would have been drawn not even from all just white men in the community. It would have been a more select group, so to speak. So a likelihood that you were going to get at least some Klansmen on this jury was pretty high. There's a man who's written a pretty apologetic biography of Hugo Black's early years named Stephenson. He lives now in Atlanta, and we had some sparring about this event years ago, and he defended Hugo Black's defense and said that, and defended Hugo Black's decision to join the Klan, which he said was on the right side of labor in the struggles with the corporate leaders of Birmingham that really ran the steel town. I'm sorry, I just don't buy it. Nor do I buy his notion that the jury would have been drawn from a more fair representation of them. I think he really has studied as carefully as he should.
The governor actually implement any changes? I mean, he said, stuff needs to change. And then kind of as a follow-up, when and how did religion
He would have had to implement those changes through the legislature that had passed the convent inspection law. But it's pretty courageous for the governor to say that. One of our better regarded governors. After I served as attorney general, there were some people who had urged me to be governor, and I said, why would I want that job? Who remembers any good governor of Alabama? They would say, well, you could be the first. Emmett O'Neill might have been the first.
And what caused kind of like religious relations to improve in the past 100 years, or do you still have problems in Birmingham?
No, I think that a lot of things helped. I mean, the civil rights movement was important for everybody. The civil rights movement, was, of course, a major struggle in a lot of places, but nowhere more so than Birmingham, which was, of course, nicknamed Bummingham. So I can see from the window of my chambers the 16th Street Baptist Church, which on September 15, 1963, was bombed, and where the four little girls, were killed. And as Attorney General, I worked with Doug Jones and prosecuting some of the Klansmen responsible for that bombing. I think that event and the fact that the Klan would target a church on Sunday and that four little girls would die changed not only a lot of minds around the country north of the Mason-Dixon line, but also a lot of people in Birmingham. Some of it was already changing, kind of the infamous race baiter Bull Connor had already lost re-election to the county commission. They had changed the city government's form of government. But he was certainly someone who was losing his grip on power. I think the bombing of the church was as an important event for the country as it was for Birmingham. A lot of things. The civil rights movement saw a lot of Catholic priests and Jewish leaders come and march from Selma to Montgomery alongside Dr. King and others. It was really a movement led by religious leaders and not just Protestant leaders, and I think that did a lot. And there have been a lot of things that have occurred since then, a lot of cultural changes. No matter what your position may be on the issue, one thing that changed relations between a lot of evangelical Protestants and Catholics was the pro-life movement. That changed things a lot. Yes.
I'm curious what you think this trial situation says about the relationship between like trial and appellate judges. I know criminal cases might be a little different, but especially with you having the appellate judge experience, what role do you see for appellate judges in reviewing the trial court decisions? I mean, there are many decisions that happen in a trial, but How do you view your role in making sure that justice is done?
Well, there's an example where, again, you're talking about jury nullification. There's a limit to what we can do. Obviously, an acquittal is not something that leads to an acquittal. And that's another part of the design of the system to ensure that we're not wrongfully convicting the innocent. And again, I think that's as it should be. So several years ago, we had a case involving a former member of Congress who was charged with federal corruption issues and charges. And she was a colorful member of Congress. Jury deliberations, near the beginning of jury deliberations, one of the jurors said, I think this congresswoman's name is Corinne Brown. I think the Holy Spirit told me that Corinne Brown's not guilty on all charges. And the other juror said, I think we need to talk about the evidence. And so he did. And so he said something like, I prayed a lot about this, and this is what Corinne Brown has told me. I mean, the Holy Spirit has told me. But then he participated in deliberations. One of the jurors passed a note to the judge, and the judge, probably wrongly, brought the juror back and questioned him about this. I don't know that it was necessary to do that because they were deliberating, and he was participating in deliberations. And this juror, pretty confident African American evangelical tradition, spoke in language that might be common to members of churches of those kinds of congregations in the South. But if you listen, if you read carefully what he said from the transcript, he said, "Look, I understand my duty, my religious duty, and that is to go by the testimony and the written." And it wasn't clear to me that he had committed misconduct. You know, don't get me wrong. I thought the congresswoman was guilty. But the judge nevertheless dismissed this juror. And we have a system that says the judge should not dismiss a juror for misconduct during deliberation unless from the evidence it is clear beyond a reasonable doubt there's no possibility this juror is performing proper service. This is a case that I was a panel dissenter and then ended up writing the en banc opinion for our court, and I said it's just not clear that this juror was engaged in misconduct. So there's a stark example of the role an appellate court can play. But I think the jury system is a good one, and I think we ought to realize that sometimes ordinary citizens speak in different terms than judges are familiar with, or that students at the University of Chicago might be familiar with. And when you really parse what the statements of this juror, it's pretty clear that he might well have understood his duty, and what he said about the Holy Spirit might have been no more than, I've thought about this prayerfully, and this is what my conscience tells me. A lot of religious people actually speak that way. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Judge Pryor. Judge Pryor, I was wondering if you could speak to how your faith has influenced your professional decisions in your career.
There's a lecture I sometimes give about how faith properly informs a judge. And the most fundamental way is in understanding my oath of office. The founders, at the time of the founding, the adoption of the Constitution, most of the states actually had a religious oath required. So you would have to profess loyalty to the Protestant understanding of Christianity. Of course, we dispensed with that in the federal Constitution. And the thinking was, look, if you're an unprincipled atheist, you could take that as a false oath and not have any fear of eternal punishment. And if you're a religious person, you'll take the oath seriously anyway. So there's no need for the religious test. In fact, we banned religious tests in the Constitution. So that's So the most fundamental way is taking that oath seriously, taking my duty to obey the law seriously. I encountered some issues with that as Attorney General when I prosecuted a man named Roy Moore, who was then the Chief Justice of Alabama, because he refused to obey a federal injunction to remove a monument of the Ten Commandments he had placed in our state judicial building. And I went up to a Baptist university, Samford University, at the law school where I taught at Samford, and as Attorney General gave a speech about why, as a Christian, I was compelled to disagree with him and to prosecute him on charges of misconduct when he refused to obey that court order. But religion doesn't allow me to supplant my faith for the law. In fact, it compels me to follow the law. And if I ever had a conflict between what my faith required and what the law required, I would have to either recuse myself or resign the office. Fortunately, in the American experiment, I don't really encounter those kinds of problems. I can, it doesn't mean I always agree with the law, but enforcing the law, which protects the freedom of all of us, is not something that creates a moral conflict. It's always fun to, yes, sir.
Thank you for coming, Judge. Here you presented a pretty clear example of governmental misconduct from the judicial branch.
Yeah.
Usually, we think of governmental misconduct as coming from the legislative or the executive branch. We think of the judiciary as the check on those sorts of abuses and excesses. Do you have any thoughts on what the checks on judicial excesses should look like going forward? Because they don't seem to be great ones.
I think you discount how good the judiciary actually is. I mean that, and it has been throughout my experience from being a law clerk in the 1980s to today. I wish people could see, many of you will clerk, and I think that'll be a great experience, and you'll get to see how much work we put into every case behind the scenes in ways that people don't even see, where sometimes the lawyering is really bad, or we have pro se litigants, and the judges, no matter what president's appointed them, are trying to ensure that every case is decided according to the law. So no branch is perfect. We should feel free to criticize the judicial branch when it merits criticism, not by personally attacking judges, but if their rulings should be attacked, the challenging the correctness of them, I think, is totally appropriate. As citizens, as lawyers, as the other branches, impeachment was supposed to be a remedy. It has been a remedy sometimes in egregious cases. Most judges in America are elected, so the people get to hold them accountable pretty often. One of the real problems of the country about dealing with corruption is that we no longer have investigative journalism. With the death of local newspapers, you just don't see nearly the level of investigative journalism that we used to have. And that's something we've got to figure out in our country as a check on all the branches. Not a branch of the government, but something that is protected in the First Amendment. A free press has a vital role to play as well. Roll Tide.
Roll Tide. So you used to appear before judges when you were Attorney General. What is something that frustrated you that you now, once you're on the other side, can see why it's procedural setup or how judges approach cases?
The slowness of judicial decisions, they used to frustrate me. It still does frustrate me a bit. I'm probably kind of pushing my colleagues to remember that we're here to decide cases, but I also understand how much judges want to make sure we get it right before we issue a decision, because we don't really, we can, but we don't really get much of a decision to take it back, and we don't want it. It's embarrassing to take something back. But you have to be willing to do that as well. You have to be willing to admit when you've made a mistake and not be obstinate about it. But I would say if I have a better appreciation for why litigation takes as long as it does. It doesn't frustrate me, though, any less, because people are depending on the courts for decisions, and the process is too slow and, frankly, too expensive. So I now see both sides of it better, but I'm not sure that I've changed my view that much on it. Yes?
Do you think that attorney's Black's tactics made a difference, or do you think...
That's a good question. Kind of that's the question. I don't know. I mean, he certainly acted like it made a difference. I think there's some belief that there were Klansmen on the jury, but maybe not all of them were. I think that all of them, at least, were susceptible to his appeals to prejudice. But I assume they weren't all Klansmen. And I assume, too, that in a fairer trial, there's a chance that maybe there would have been a mistrial and another trial. But I have to think that the judge's performance at the preliminary hearing and the grand jury's performance of at least returning an indictment for second-degree murder suggests that it was at least possible, if the trial had been fairer, that there would have been a conviction. That's a great question, and I think it's hard to say what the answer is.
Please join me in thanking Jim Pryor.